Hello viewers, today we are going to see about emerging capabilities across domains related to cognition, metacognition, creativity and ethics. The main objective of this unit is to impart knowledge on emerging capabilities across domains related to cognition, metacognition, creativity and ethics. We live in an amazing world. The greatest of all creations is man himself, the wonderful machine, specific and resourceful. Perhaps the most enthralling and pertinent scientific exploration is with the human brain, being the most complex structure in the universe and also the greatest wonder of creation. Did you ever wonder what was going on inside our heads? Just how does the information taking in become actual knowledge? Well, wonder no more, because today, we are going to walk through the process of how we learn through cognition. The brain weighs only 1,500 grams but contains more than 10,000 million nerve cells. Each nerve cell creates new connections and trains up the cognitive processes. Cognition refers to the ways the mind goes about perceiving, remembering, and thinking. Cognition is a mental action or process of acquiring knowledge and understanding through thought, experience and the senses. It includes processes such as knowledge, attention, memory, judgment and evaluation, problem solving and decision making, comprehension and production of language. Human cognition is conscious and unconscious, concrete and abstract, as well as intuitive and conceptual. Let's see the origin of cognition. The word cognition dates back to the 15th century, meaning thinking and awareness. Attention to the cognitive process came about more than 18 centuries ago, beginning with the human's interest in the inner workings of the mind and how they affect the human experience. The Greek philosopher Aristotle focused on cognitive areas pertaining to memory, perception, and mental imagery. Later, when psychology became an important field of study, other scientists like William Wundt, Hermann Ebbinghaus, and Mary Witten Calkins, and also William James, offered their contributions to the study of cognition. Cognitive psychology emerged in the late 1950s. As the opposition to the prevalent behaviorism of the time. Authors such as Piaget and Vygotsky revolutionized the scientific panorama with their theories about development and cognitive learning, which are still relevant today. Starting in the 60s, interest in cognition and cognitive skills grew exponentially, and the research that it generated allowed us to learn more about these processes. What is cognition? Cognition is a scientific term for the process of thought. Usage of the term varies in different disciplines. For example, in psychology and cognitive science, it usually refers to an information processing view of an individual's psychological function. The term cognition is derived from a Latin word cognoscere, which means to know, to conceptualize, or to recognize. And it refers to a faculty for the processing of information, applying knowledge, and changing preferences. Cognitive processes can be natural or artificial, conscious or unconscious. These processes are analyzed from different perspectives within different contexts, notably in the fields of linguistics, anesthesia, neurology, psychology, philosophy, anthropology, systemic and computer science. In general, cognition refers to the mental functions and mental processes. The most accepted definition of cognition is the ability to process information through perception, knowledge acquired through experience, and our subjective characteristics that allow us to integrate all of this information to evaluate and interpret our world. Cognition can be understood as the ability that we have to assimilate and process the information that we receive from different sources like perception, experience, and beliefs and convert them into knowledge. What are cognitive processes? Cognitive processes use existing knowledge and generate new knowledge. Different cognitive functions play a role in these processes, namely perception, attention, memory, reasoning. Each of these cognitive functions work together to integrate the new knowledge and create an interpretation of the world around us. What's perception? Cognitive perception helps us to organize and understand the world through stimuli that we receive from our different senses like sight, hearing, taste, smell, and touch. While most people are familiar with the common senses, there are some other less known senses like proprioception, which means stimuli which unconsciously perceives our position in space and judges spatial orientation, and interoception, which means the perception of our organs in our bodies. It is what allows us to know when we are hungry or thirsty. Once the stimuli are received, our brain integrates all of the information, creating a new memory. Next, we'll see attention. Attention is a cognitive process which helps us to concentrate on a stimuli or activity in order to process it more thoroughly later. Attention is a fundamental cognitive function. Consider a mechanism that controls and regulates the rest of the cognitive processes. That's from perception to learning and complex reasoning. Memory. Memory is a cognitive process that helps us to code, store, and recover information from the past. Memory is a basic process for learning, as it is what allows us to create a sense of identity. There are many types of memory, like short-term memory, which is the ability to retain information for a short period of time, and long-term memory, which are all of the memories that we keep for a long period of time. Other types of memory are auditory memory, contextual memory, naming, and recognition. Next is thought. Thought is fundamental for all cognitive processes. It allows us to integrate all of the information that we have received and establish relationships between events and knowledge using reasoning, synthesis, and problem solving. Language. Language is the ability to express our thoughts and feelings through spoken word. It is a tool that we use to communicate and organize and transmit information that we have about ourselves and the world. Language and thought are developed together and are closely related. They mutually influence each other. Learning. Learning is the cognitive process that incorporates new information into our prior knowledge. Learning includes things as diverse as behaviors or habits, like brushing our teeth or learning how to walk, and knowledge that we learn through socialization. Piaget and other authors have talked about cognitive learning as the process of information entering our cognitive system and changing it. The cognitive processes can occur naturally or artificially, or consciously or unconsciously, but it usually happens fast. They work constantly, and even we do not even realize it. Differentiating cognition and metacognition is a tough job. They are closely related and can often overlap. Flavel described an example such as asking yourself questions about the chapter might function either to improve your knowledge as a cognitive function, or to monitor it is considered to be a metacognitive function. Metacognition. Metacognition means thinking about thinking. The term has been part of the vocabulary of educational psychologists for the last couple of decades, and the concept for as long as humans have been able to reflect on their cognitive experience. According to Flavel, 1987, Metacognition consists of both metacognitive knowledge and metacognitive experiences. Metacognitive knowledge refers to acquiring knowledge about cognitive processes. Metacognitive experiences refers to the experiences that have something to do with the ongoing cognitive endeavor. Metacognition is essential for successful learning because it enables individuals to better manage their cognitive skills and to determine weaknesses that can be corrected by constructing new cognitive skills. Metacognition has two aspects. One is knowledge about cognition, and the next one is monitoring and regulating the cognition. Several frameworks have been developed for categorizing the types of knowledge about cognition. The three types are person knowledge, which includes anything one believes about the nature of human beings as cognitive processes. Task knowledge, which includes knowledge about the demands of different tasks. And strategy knowledge, which is knowledge about the types of strategies likely to be most useful. Now we will see the different components of metacognition. We have seen metacognition consists of two components, knowledge and regulation. Metacognitive knowledge includes knowledge about oneself as a learner and the factors that might impact performance, knowledge about strategies, and knowledge about when and why to use the strategies. Metacognitive regulation is the monitoring of one's cognition and includes planning activities, awareness of comprehension and task performance, and evaluation of the efficacy of monitoring processes and strategies. First, we'll see the different aspects related to knowledge of cognition. Knowledge of cognition is how learners know about themselves as a learner and resources before beginning the task. According to Shaw and Denison, knowledge of cognition has three subcomponents, namely declarative knowledge, procedural knowledge, and conditional knowledge. Declarative knowledge, it is how learners know about themselves as a learner, about their own weaknesses and strengths, and about their relationships with the tasks that they want to accomplish, such as learning or problem solving. What's procedural knowledge? It is to know how and what strategies learners can use to accomplish their task. Then what's conditional knowledge? It is to know when and under what conditions learners can use a particular strategy to achieve their goals. Now we will see regulation of cognition. Regulation of cognition is to control the cognition. It consists of five subcomponents such as planning, information management strategies, comprehension monitoring, debugging strategies, and evaluation. What is planning? Planning refers to goal setting and allocating resources prior to learning. Information management strategies. It includes skills to process information, such as organizing and elaborating. What's comprehension monitoring? It entails assessing one's comprehension and learning processes, whether the reading materials make sense or not. Debugging strategies. It is to look for help when encountering difficulties. Evaluation. It is to assess oneself to see whether he or she has accomplished his or her jobs. Now we are moving on to the next new aspect, namely creativity. The word creativity comes from the Latin term creo, which means to create or to make. Its derivational suffixes also come from Latin. Creativity is a phenomenon whereby something new and somehow valuable is formed. The created item may be intangible, such as an idea, a scientific theory, a musical composition, or a joke, or it may be a physical object, such as an invention, a literary work, or a painting. Creativity is the backbone of allowing a student to see the breadth of a single idea and how that can be pushed to its limits. There are different components of creativity. The main four components of creativity as described by psychologist Ellis P. Torrance, are fluency, flexibility, originality, and elaboration. Fluency is the ability to produce a number of different ideas. Fluency can be enhanced by providing children with plenty of opportunities that stimulate the thought process. Ask open-ended questions, and questions that ask the child's opinion comes under this category. Encourage a child to explore and experiment, and this will enhance cognitive growth. The second component is flexibility. It is the ability to approach different situations and develop solutions from a number of different perspectives. Flexibility can be fostered by allowing a lot of opportunities to explore and experiment. Allowing children to experiment and make mistakes unleashes their creative thinking and a sense of wonder. Third component is originality. It is the ability to have a new or novel idea. To promote originality, provide a variety of supplies and experiences in which children can use their imagination and create. The final component is elaboration. That's the ability to extend ideas. Give children new ways of doing old ideas and activities. Now we are moving on to the four stages of creativity. The first stage is called preparation. This is the stage where the thinker formulates a problem and collects the facts and materials considered necessary for finding new solutions. Many times, the problem cannot be solved even after days, weeks, or months of concentrated efforts. Failing to solve the problem, the thinker moves away from it, initiating the next stage of creativity called incubation. In this period, some of the ideas that were interfering with the solution will tend to fail. It seems that the overt activity and sometimes even thinking about the problem is absent in this stage, but the unconscious thought process is at work during this period. The thinker may be busy in other activities like reading or playing games. In spite of these activities, the desire to find a solution to the problem will be going on in the thinker's mind. That's a stage called incubation. Third stage is illumination. Following the period of incubation, the creative ideas occur suddenly. Consequently, the obscure thing becomes very clear. This sudden flash of solution is known as illumination and is sometimes referred to aha experience or eureka experience. For example, this stage could be easily connected to the way by which Archimedes found solution to the crown problem. The fourth stage is verification. Even if the solution is found in illumination stage, it is necessary to verify whether that solution is correct or not. Hence, in this last stage, evaluation of the solution is done. If the solution is not satisfactory, the thinker will go back to creative process from the beginning. We'll see what's the relationship between creativity and intelligence. There are multiple theories accounting for the relationship with three main theories as threshold theory. One of the theories is called threshold theory, another one is certification theory, and third is the interference theory. What is threshold theory saying? It says intelligence is necessary but not sufficient condition for creativity. There is a moderate positive relationship between creativity and intelligence until IQ is almost approximately equal to 120. Certification theory says creativity is not intrinsically related to intelligence. Instead, individuals are required to meet the requisite level of intelligence in order to gain a certain level of educational worth, which then in turn offers the opportunity to be creative. Interference theory says extremely high intelligence sometimes might interfere with the creative ability. Sternberg and O'Hara proposed a framework of five possible relationships between creativity and intelligence. They say creativity is a subset of intelligence. Intelligence is also a subset of creativity. Creativity and intelligence are overlapping constructs. Creativity and intelligence are part of the same construct. Creativity and intelligence are distinct concepts. Now let's see about ethics and morality. Morality refers to the way people choose to live their lives according to a set of guidelines or principles that govern their decisions about right versus wrong and good versus evil. At the present time, ethical or moral issues are as important as scientific and technological activities and progress. Science and technology provides us with the capacity to possess systematic knowledge of natural and human realities and to improve the conditions of our material life. Majority of the people are of the opinion that today's generation lacks moral values and are not sure of the ethical values. The youngsters or adolescents are the future of tomorrow, so the lack of moral values, especially among them, must be an important aspect that has to be taken care of, as it's a serious issue related to society. The reasons for the lack of moral values among adolescents are many. The most important one is the disturbances in the families, as family is the key factor behind moral crisis because children acquire moral values from the family. When the family is unstable and parents are emotionally distant from their children due to any reason, maybe they are preoccupied with their own problems or due to work pressure, the process of acquiring moral values is disrupted and difficult. Globalization is also responsible for the transitional period, which includes longer schooling due to career consciousness, earlier puberty, late marriages, separation from adults and parents. At the stage of adolescence, they believe that they can try anything for the sake of their pleasure or do anything what they want to do, hardly matter what parents suggest. At that stage, the role of parents and teachers should come. There should be a cooperation and partnership between elders and adolescents instead of obedience and hierarchy. In that sense, it's important to emphasize that the higher the closeness between the children and their parents, the bigger the acceptance of values in them. It clearly indicates a big failure of parents, and they are just shifting the responsibility in the heads of teachers. It is a joint responsibility of both. In order to remove the problem, the suggested measures are parental interactions. Children learn the basic values of behavior and living from their parents. Children, in fact, learn by example, and whatever home they are actually living in will shape how they make moral decisions. When children experience interactions inside and outside the home in which they feel safe and cared for, and where anger and hostility are not present, they develop a strong sense of self, which develops into a strong moral base. The second point is role models interactions. Other than parents, teachers and schools also play a pivotal role in shaping the morals of the next generation. They place a high value on character traits such as honesty, integrity, and compassion, and teachers who exhibit these attributes will naturally pass them along. Inconsistency and hypocrisy on the part of teachers and parents alike can cause real harm to a child's moral development. Children need guidance in choosing proper role models that will best shape their moral development. Parents have the greatest influence in a child's life. Social interactions. Children need various forms of social interaction to develop into well-rounded adults. These include interacting with other adults, family members, and other children older and younger than them. Each interaction will reinforce or challenge a child's preconceived ideas about what's morally acceptable. To inculcate moral values among adolescents, it should be an ongoing process and should start as soon as a child takes birth. Teens must make moral judgments on a daily basis. When children are younger, their family, culture, and religion greatly influence their moral decision making. However, during the early adolescent period, peers have a much greater influence. Peer pressure can exert a powerful influence because friends play a most significant role in teens' lives. Furthermore, the new ability to think abstractly enables you to recognize that rules are simply created by other people. By late adolescence, most teens are less rebellious as they have begun to establish their own identity, their own belief system, and their own place in the world. Some youth who have reached the highest levels of moral development may feel passionate about their moral code. As such, they may choose to participate in activities that demonstrate their moral convictions. As the youngster's cognitive, emotional, and social development continues to mature, their understanding of morality expands and their behavior becomes more closely aligned with their values and beliefs. Lacking a moral compass, these youth may never reach their full potential and may find it difficult to form meaningful and rewarding relationships with others. Ethics may find difficult or challenging to follow. It's important to remember that this developmental step is essential to their children's well-being and ultimate success in life. Thank you so much.